a debutante writer at a festival, because that's what we should be doing, actually. We should be showcasing writers who are doing interesting work. And this book is extremely interesting because it's the kind of book my son's generation really digs. And that's a graphic novel in part. And then to soothe the nerves of mothers like mine, the same novel is again in novel form. So this is a dual-facing novel written by Aritra Sarkar, and it's based entirely in China, which is another interesting facet of this book, because very few novels written in India really are entirely set in China in particular. So I'd like to welcome the novelist, the artist, and the moderator. So first, Aritra Sarkar. This is his first book, so let's give him a warm round. With Ritwick Roy, and in conversation with them is Arunava Sinha.
I'm very excited about being here with these two young men, Aritra and Ritwick. The reason is that we were having a chat backstage a little earlier, and what they told me about what they're doing is very, very exciting from many different aspects. And we are hoping today to be able to delve into each of these. We were going to start with an audiovisual, but are we still doing that? We are. Are we ready for the audiovisual? After a while. Okay, fine. So, just to set a little background, we are talking to Aritra and Ritwick about a graphic novel that they, along with other members of their team, have produced. And perhaps one of the most exciting things about this graphic novel is that it has not been written by one person. A graphic novel, of course, is usually not. There is usually an artist and someone who's writing the story. But in this case, this novel has really been produced like a movie with a full-fledged team and virtually a director and a producer. So we are going to find out more about the process of creating this book as though it were a film. It's also very interesting in that it is both a graphic novel and a conventional long story, all both put into one volume. So let's start by talking about the novel, which is named Goliath in Shenzen. Now, very interesting choice of location, Shenzen. Do you want to tell us why you chose Shenzen and how it fits into your scheme of things, Aritra?
Well, actually, the whole story is about freedom and the contradictions around freedom to a great extent. And I felt like I needed a canvas to write the story, a canvas which could sort of portray the starkness of the choices of the character in more black and white themes. India, of course, is a very, it's a much more complex terrain because we are a democracy, so we have certain freedom. But of course, a lot of freedoms have also been restricted and denied us as well over the years. But it's more complicated to show exactly what I was trying to say at that point of time within an Indian framework. I felt the Chinese setup is far more repressive overall politically, and so a lot of the choices of the characters get amplified within that context. And as far as Shenzhen is concerned, as I started writing on it, industrialization became a theme in the story. And then I looked at several locations, and Shenzhen is one of the biggest industrial free trade zones. And I thought that would be, it's not also something which is generally covered in fictions and novels. So I thought it would be a good place to focus on.
So the story starts with, or very early on in the story, you have the situation where a village is about to be occupied by a group of industrialists to set up an industrial complex. And that sounds eerily familiar to us here in Bengal, doesn't it?
Absolutely. And it's not just eerily familiar in Bengal. It's happened throughout the country, throughout the world, where in the name of development, farmlands and the environment has been encroached upon, over the years. While industrialization is required, there obviously needs to be some kind of a due process which is followed, that is transparent and open. But it's rarely that way.
But I was specifically alluding to Shingur and maybe Nondigram, but Shingur specifically, because of the fact that there's a violent uprising in your book as well.
Correct.
So was that at the back of your mind? Did you start with that germ?
Shingur was, I would say, not really at the back of my mind, to be fair with you. It just sort of evolved as the story started to take shape. You can say that it was in my subconscious, in a way, you know, because a lot of things which are in your subconscious tends to make their way into your creative work, whether you like it or not. So that was a, it wasn't a deliberate choice. It was, it just happened that way.
Right. So, you know, you're a young man in your 20s and, in India now, in post-liberalization urban India, freedom really, for many people, is a very narrow set of things. For young people, it's about how late they can stay out, and cosmetic aspects of freedom. And really, the focus is on expanding your career, on earning better, on buying that car, buying that house, and so on. So, why is freedom in a larger context so important to you, and indeed your team, who I assume are bought into the same concept?
It's a very important concept. I think it is probably the most important concept that exists, in my opinion, you know, because it is what I call as a gateway concept. Through the whole idea of freedom, essentially, it affects everything about our lives, you know, the way we work, the way we live, the way we engage with government, the way we pursue education, even our, the way we pray as well. You know, everything is ultimately linked to
the way we pray.
Of course, the choice of faith is dictated by the freedom that is afforded to us. I mean, I'll give you an example. I always thought when we are born, we adopt the religion of our parents. But why isn't it that we can adopt multiple religion or different aspects of different religions even when we are born? There might be aspects of Christianity, aspects of Hinduism, aspects of Islam, aspects of Buddhism, which might appeal to every one of us. But when we are born, we are only exposed to one pantheon of beliefs. One set of beliefs, instead of access, gaining access to the whole thing, and then being able to pick and choose what you want. You don't have that flexibility in the case of religion, for example. I mean, that's just a case in point. Sure. But I'm just saying that to me, freedom is a multifaceted thing. You know, and I wanted to open up this question to this book, but not necessarily solve it, because it's a much more longer-term process. I will definitely try. I think provided a solution in my next book, which will come out. But for now, I have tried to raise this question.
All right. And what are the manifestations of the lack of freedom you see in India, other than the ones you mentioned? Can you give us some specific situations or instances?
Well, I mean, I can give you, there are very few cases where actually you have unrestricted freedom in India. That's largely, if you really see, like, for example, the freedom to travel overall is constrained, you know, across the world, because you need visas to travel to different countries in the world, a permit to work, and a permit to go somewhere and settle. To me, actually, that's in a way a violation of an inalienable right, because a country decides that my boundaries are only for my citizens. Who is the country to decide whose boundary it belongs to? Just because a certain native sentiment has been around forever, then they occupy that space and they control the mobility within that space. Similarly, for example, one of the areas which I've seen freedom is very restricted is in commerce, business. It is very difficult in India, for example, to do unfettered business because of the lack of trust between citizens, government, and between businessmen as well. So no one trusts each other. So all this puts together a very, very difficult framework, in a sense, where the only freedom we have, really, I see, in our country, is to vote once in 4 years to a limited set of candidates, pretty much 80% of whom are all rogues, essentially, give or take.
You actually find 20% of them not rogues?
Well, I would be a bit optimistic and say that 20% may have shades of grey. But that being said, I think we have very limited choices. One of the aspects, I think, of freedom is to have lots of choices, quality choices. And we don't really have quality choices in our space, whether it's in politics, in education, And the whole game has been to restrict this universe of choices which is given before us in every sphere of life. You know, from a very early age, right down to the time we are adults.
So, this is a good time for you to maybe tell us a little bit more about the story that you've written.
So, the story is basically set in a fictional village called Harnex, just outside the industrial heartland called Shenzhen in China. And Harnex, by the way, doesn't exist, so it's purely my imagination. And it's settled on a hilltop just outside the village, and a hilltop which has been around forever. The community has lived in peace and harmony with nature. And then the industrialists decide to erect a junkyard for the auto factory, and then ravage this village, and to build the factory. So the villagers, usually, I mean, in China, you don't really have a choice. If the government says get out, you have to get out. But here, I think the villagers, they use their ingenuity, they use technology, they use social media, they use various tools to organize a resistance by building a robot, essentially. And the reason why I actually chose a robot is because the Chinese are much better at us than building things, by and large, you know. We are very good at thinking things, but when it comes to building actual things, we have not been as good. But the teamwork is very good, generally, you know, and they're very disciplined. So, so they build a mechanized robot, which is then powered by software. And the way they build the robot is also by outsourcing or crowdsourcing ideas from the people of Shenzhen itself. And then they organize a resistance with this technology against the Chinese military, who's hell-bent on acquiring the village. But in the process of this, a lot of contradictions get thrown up. The whole thing is that, is such a resistance doomed for failure? Is a question that comes up. Is the whole idea that can resistance be an armed struggle, or does resistance have to follow a more cerebral path? I think is a question that I sort of grappled with during the course of writing this book.
Yes, and these are the questions that you raise without necessarily going one way or the other in terms of an answer.
Correct. I mean, I wasn't really trying to solve any of these questions in this book, because I knew that I would need a much bigger space to do that. But I wanted to raise the questions, because I think the awareness of the questions is not very high, in our country. We are not very aware of a lot of these things, you know.
Right. Let's talk about the form. Now, this could have been a politically charged science fiction kind of or speculative fiction kind of novel or novella. But you decided, or did you decide, how did the thought of transforming it into a graphic novel come up?
So after I wrote this as a piece of fiction, I found that my style of writing was very cinematic in terms of being very detailed. I thought I was quite clear in the descriptions of the action scenes and all of that. And when I read it out to some people, some of my friends, they said that this would really lend itself to a graphic novel. And I wouldn't say I was a huge connoisseur of that medium, but I was definitely someone who has read a lot of graphic novels over the years. So I thought it would be a really good idea. So I discovered Ritwick on Facebook, believe it or not.
Tell us about this?
It's actually in the book. There is a section in the book called The Making, where I describe it. But after I wrote the book, I talked to a cousin of mine who's a filmmaker. His name is Rajoshi. And he recommended that I join this group called the Cryotech Comic Club, which is a Facebook community of graphic artists. So I joined that group, and I posted a request that I'm a wannabe writer, and I'm looking for a graphic artist to render an international quality project. And I got a response from Ritwick. And then I met him, and we met him actually and a colleague at Park Hotel, I remember that, in 2012. So quite a while ago, you know.
What did you drink that evening?
I think I'm not an alcoholic person, so only coffee only.
Yeah, and I think I drank my usual poison, which is water.
You guys did a graphic novel on coffee and water.
Of course.
Exactly.
This is a new kind of freedom.
Yes, okay. But
so enter Ritwick. Now tell us what you know. Walk us through what happened. How was the story pitched to you? What made it capture your imagination? And did you start thinking of visuals? How did it all work?
Exactly, from early days of my life, I tried to make comics when even I was in school. I think there are so many people like me, when they're in school, they try to make comics or something like that, become a comics artist, something like that. But seriously, frankly speaking, in India, it's really difficult to become a comics artist. So as usual, I had to go somewhere else for pursuing my occupation or something, as a new occupation, whatever. I used to make advertising films previously. So then I left the job and I tried to make something of my own. So I returned to Calcutta from Bombay after a couple of years. And then I have started with working with a small team. There's only four guys and something like that. And one day I just, that's very early days of my, that period of time. So I just got a call from Aritra, the particular Facebook page. I got saw a post and he told me there's a comics project. So I like to do something like that. So I thought seriously in India, nobody really not intend to make a graphic story. It's a graphic novel at all. Those days, apart from ACK, Amar Chitra Katha. So I just grabbed this stuff and I thought this would be a good opportunity. So I just joined with his team and so we just made a collaborative stuff. That's it.
And how did you read the story? Was it narrated to you?
Aritra just told me the story. He narrated the story in Park Hotel the particular evening. And seriously, I love the storyline. It's something different. It's not a superheroes kind of stuff and something like that. So it's kind of a bit different, and seriously, I mostly like French comics a lot rather than DC or Marvel. I definitely love to read out a lot, but I like to make or I like the artwork kind of stuff, mostly French artists. So I thought there's some kind of potentiality to make something different comics art, some kind of art. It's not similar with DC or Marvel. So I just took this opportunity. That's it.
Who are the French graphic artists whom you
I admire? Mostly like Pierre Ellery. He was a former Disney artist and later on he started his own comics with his team, just like us.
Right. So you had, I mean, broadly speaking, I would say there are maybe four different kinds of graphic art in comics nowadays. There's, as you said, the DC Marvel school, then there's the European school, and there's also a stylized American-Canadian version, you know, V for Vendetta, or so on. And then there's the Japanese style,
manga.
Which is manga as well as the non-manga, the most
anime as well.
Yeah, but I think they flow from one another. So which of them were you most inspired by?
Seriously, for last almost decades, I used to nurture with a different comic style from around the world. I nurtured so many stuff, but seriously, the mostly European stuff, mostly French comics, I loved a lot. Apart from this, I could say some of the DC Marvel artists, I also like it. But at the very end of the day, I like, you know, that's not traditional comics exactly, but I like kind of stuff, you know, that soft comics, as we can say, soft comics, you know, like, I can tell you one thing. Long time back, there's an English newspaper that's published in London. I forgot the name of the newspaper right now. But they used to make a dual color facing of comics kind of stuff. And that's the time I was in college. Incidentally, I got this particular newspaper. I like the stuff. And I like to just practice all the stuff with my help of my grandfather. He was basically a graphic artist. And from then on, seriously, I mostly...
Sorry, did you say your grandfather was a graphic artist?
Yes.
What's his name?
He's not eminent at all. He is basically a school principal. But there's another good story. I can tell you that. Exactly. That grandfather is my mother's father. When I used to return from my mother's father after the vacations, each and every week, he used to send me a letter. And the letter is completely fully illustrated. So those are the preliminary days of my comics style that I got from the particular guy. So, and initially those days he used to make so many stuff, like he used to give some books and those comics books from Europe. So that's why I'm more intent with this European comic style. So rather than American one.
Right. So now, tell us, you know, you as a writer, you have complete control over your medium. And suddenly now here you're getting into a situation where a whole bunch of other people will be involved, including a script writer. So you didn't write the script yourself, is that right?
Well, I would say I collaborated again on the script, but yeah, the script was actually written by a script writer.
And why did you feel the need for someone else to...
Well, that's largely because, you know, the comic script, just like a film script, is a professional job, you know. It's not something which one should attempt without the necessary skills, you know. And I'm quite big on in general, on having people with the best skill sets for a particular role. And this gentleman was actually working with Ritwick at that time. And, you know, he knew how to do it. He was very good. So, because I didn't really know how to... develop a comic book script in that sense, because, you know, you have to develop in panels, there was a certain sequence, so there's a whole craft behind it as well, you know. I thought it'd be best to get someone who really understands this this field.
And eventually the team expanded to how many people?
There's five only. The five artists, exactly the how many characters even that book is there. There's a four guys and one girl, so the same team.
That's quite uncanny.
Yes.
I have actually a girl who is the female character in the book.
Yes.
She is a cerebral kind of a person.
Yes.
You know, she's not the typical sort of superheroine kind of a character. And I deliberately also put her in the technology role, because generally there are very few women in leading technology today. You know, and I hope through this actually I inspire more women to join technology and sciences, which generally doesn't happen that much.
But she's also maybe somewhat inevitably the fulcrum of certain fault lines within the group of five as well.
She is as well. That of course, is there. But, I mean, the real fault lines lie within the group themselves. You know, it's I think can't really blame any one person
sure.
for it. It's who you are.
Right. So you were you very comfortable with the notion that instead of, as I said, one person writing a book, you now have a team virtually making a film?
Yes, absolutely. I looked at this project like a film, in a sense. You know, it was a complete project. No one person can do everything in such a project. You know, and a book usually is quite a lonely pursuit, generally. So when I wrote the story, edited it, that was my lonely pursuit. But then when I wanted to put it in this format, I really felt like it needed to be something which merged both the graphic and the prose styles. So that's when I really realized that I needed a good team, which, you know, who could actually execute that.
But who was did you have the equivalent of a film director?
Not quite. You can say that we had an editor who, who's also part of my company, the startup which I currently run. And he is he's an amazingly talented person, and he oversaw both the content of the prose and the graphic side. But no, we didn't have an overall director. You can say I assumed that role.
Right. This would be a good time. Is the audiovisual ready? Can we have it, please? Okay. We're going to have an audiovisual which will give you, I mean, that's the best way. We can't keep talking about things. But meanwhile, tell us why graphic novel? It's not mainstream yet.
So
you're trying to talk to a mainstream audience.
Absolutely. The idea, of course, the story is a very serious story. It's not a comic story in that sense, you know, because I think our market, largely India, is still dominated by mythology in the graphic space. But, if you look at it abroad, mostly all the serious stories, political stories, are told in the graphic form. So I was thinking why, you know, I wanted to create a story which is political. But the thing is, you know, because my mindset is very international, in the sense that, the way it happened, I ended up writing about China. So there may not be a direct cultural connect, but I wanted to create a connect which is more at an issue level. And the younger generation... particularly to get them into reading, I felt the visual medium is a good medium to get them into reading. So I use the graphic form more as a tool, a storytelling aid, rather than rather than using it in itself. you follow what I'm saying.
Right, yeah, sure. So there's a sort of communication strategy behind the whole thing.
Well, I wouldn't call it a communication strategy. I will just say that there is a, you know, there's a marketing strategy to the book. As I want to, you know, we want to reach out and, you know, really get younger readers at the end of the younger people to engage on freedom, engage on these issues. Because unfortunately, today, you know, we live in an age of conformism, you know, where conformism, we are keeping on being asked in subtle ways to conform to a norm. You know, whether the norm is that set by the peers or by the company, it's always falling in line with a certain system. And I really want, in a sense, the younger generation to break out of this mold like they did in the 60s and the 70s, you know. And that's why, you know, this story has been sort of brought to the fore. You know, because unless the younger generation start asking and questioning existing paradigms, existing issues, then, you know, only then will society change.
Right. Are we ready with the audiovisual? Okay. Maybe not. Let me ask about the, since you mentioned the fact that you're looking at engaging young people and checking for their responses, I understand that you've taken the experience beyond the book.
Correct.
And
correct,
you're, you've created other channels as well. So correct. Do you want to tell us about those and what kind of responses you're getting?
Absolutely. So the book is just the beginning. You know, it's, I call it as, you know, it's the first conversation with people in a sense on this, on these various issues. But we've actually published, it's published under a label called Vidoria Chronicles, which is the publishing arm of the startup that we are running. And basically what Vidoria Chronicles is trying to do is to unearth basically stories of a new world. So we mostly find that the books that have come out today, they talk about issues that are confronted currently, you know, in the world. But no one is really talking about what is that better world in which we should live in? What is that new paradigm of values, of consciousness that we should all step into. Very few books, very few companies actually talking about that. So I wanted to create an entire new publishing ecosystem which would be focused on this. And this book is the first in this series, but there are many books coming up. A lot of them written by me initially, but also we are trying to unearth new writers who will come up with very innovative, new, original tales. And so we've started an initiative in the Calcutta Book Fair where you can send in a short story around five or six different themes like freedom, like passion, you can submit it. And then if they'll be rated by the audience themselves, and then the best ones will get published in an upcoming book. You know, so this way we want to generate or identify new authors. And over a period of time, we want to change the way the publishing industry identifies talent, because it's a closed community. Generally, unless you know someone in the publishing industry personally, it's very difficult to break in. You know, so the future, however, belongs to open access, where you know anyone should be able to come in and voice out their talent, and if it's good, it should be accepted. You shouldn't have to run around hoops. You know? So that's in a sense the kind of ecosystem which we are trying to build through. Vidoria Chronicles.
So I see a great cross-pollination of ideas from the software business which you're involved in.
Absolutely. It's a very good synergy between technology and media creativity. Such a synergy has never happened before. And I think such a synergy is possible because I'm a writer and a creative person. At the same time, I'm handling a business of technology. So I can probably merge the two in a way that, it's not happening right now.
No? Yeah. So there are some specific things you're doing both on your Facebook page and at your on the ground at the Calcutta Book Fair. So yeah. Would either of you like to tell us something about this or tell people? Okay, so maybe we'll stop now and watch the AV first. Thank you. I think that's a great way of introducing everyone to what's in here. And it's an interesting production as well, because this is the graphic novel and this is the novel in words. So this is a good time also, if I'm going to ask Aritra to read a little bit from the text, if you will.
I must say I wasn't the best at elocution, but I'll try my best here. I'll just start with the first segment. Every sunrise in the desolate scrapyard of Xiaoming Auto Yards, the shadow of a crow would fly past the highest point. Every day, the same crow swooped down to the same point in the same junkyard. The junkyard was located on the Han Mountain, a mountain that was more hill-like and less of a mountain than one might think, given the gravitas of its name. The crow was remarkably observant, and from its vantage point, its gaze swept past the sprawling industrial landscape of Shenzhen. The auto yard was a central dumping ground of all industrial waste generated by the auto cluster, a gigantic depot of scrap metal, rubber, steel and tires, bodies of cars, trucks, motorbikes and jeeps strewn all over the place and on top of each other like road rage mayhem on an express highway. The crow was careful to perch itself at sunrise because it had just a couple of hours to itself to meditate before the ferreting ants, cockroaches, spiders, and tiny critters started crawling out of the metallic templates before an army of rats from the adjacent dumping ground started burrowing into the zone, and another hour before a second army of equally loutish brats from the neighboring village stomped in to invade its hallowed grounds.
Thank you. Yes. Right, so this really is one of the most exciting things that I've seen in publishing in recent times. So we'll come back to that discussion about what this can mean for publishing, but going back to that question about the ways in which you're getting people to add to the content here, both through Facebook and your on the ground initiatives.
Yeah, so in a sense, what we're actually seeing is, you know, the if you really look at the way books and publishing traditionally works, is it's a one-way traffic, which is that, say, as an author, you bring out your works, and then the reader reads it, and that's basically where it ends, essentially. You know, there is really no interaction or no scope for readers to interact and contribute to an author's work. I think the future is going to be different. You know, the future will be that you have a book, and it's just a starting point, you know. It should not be viewed as the be-all and end-all of it. So then as people start coming up with their suggestions and contributions, that's the way I look at it, everyone can be a reviewer, you know. Why should the reviewer be a guy from a newspaper or a magazine, you know? The average person can also be a reviewer. And then you start taking in, as an author, you start taking in all these inputs. You start recognizing and start interacting with your readers. And you build a community around them, and you also start improving your content, you know. Because I think one of the things I've really tried to sort of not be affected by is the literary ego, which is that, you know, I have done this and I think I know best, you know, this is the best. And I think that's destructive for the arts, because anyone who thinks that there is no scope for improvement is at the end of the day only cutting himself in the legs, you know. I don't think there's any end to our evolution, in a sense, you know. So that's why actually we've started this movement on social media to get people to contribute by using this as a starting point, in a sense, you know, and start getting people to contribute, you know, their passions, their ideas, their stories. And then we as a company will monetize them, will help them to monetize them, will help them to bring them out. So I think there's tremendous scope for a future which is collaborative in terms of creation instead of insular in terms of creation.
You're really challenging a very fundamental concept of both the creation as well as the industrialization of art, which right. is that one, you're saying that one, the individual integrity is not the best thing that there needs to be, that maybe a collective gathering and then knitting it into one whole might be a better choice.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't use those words. I think the individual integrity is always paramount, but the thing is that there needs to be a way to kind of merge and to bring the collective with the individual together, you know. So I mean, while let's say I might be doing a painting, for example, right? And I'm doing the painting, I should do it my own way. That's fine, you know. Similarly, I'm writing it, but you know, the fact is that when I actually start, showing other people, start interacting with people, then ideas get sparked off. Particularly, you know, when you're interacting with people who are not in your own field, that's when it happens. You know, unexpected, things can happen when you bump into strangers, for example, right? So there's a scope for then improvement of what you're doing, you know, which otherwise would not have happened. Now, I'm not saying you ultimately implement that. That's totally your choice. But the fact is that you should be open to it, you know. So I think that's what I'm actually getting at, is at least you should open up the entire conversations and idea space, and then allow people, creators, to ultimately, you know, create. Because, yeah, you're right. I mean, there are beautiful things about the creation process now. I don't think, like, if I had, for me, the collaboration happened once the text was over, but I mean, I would be open, for example, to someone continuing the story as well, you know, in their own way. Why
Which
not?
Is pretty much what happens in television, for example.
Absolutely.
It is a group of writers and they pitch, and then somebody sits and says, yeah, this works, that doesn't work.
Absolutely.
And so on. Yeah. You're also talking about making curation an art form.
Yes.
It's not just curation anymore. That is the very, it becomes a creative process in itself.
Yes. I think curation, by and large, is something which is very opaque and you know, it basically starts off with selection. So in my view, you know, every human being should have the right to contribute fundamentally, you know, and the freedom to contribute is actually, I believe, what makes us, what is, I think, the basic freedoms which should be ensured. And by freedom to contribute, I mean that there should be no one individual that says that blocks your work from seeing the light of day. And the way to actually do that is that you must have open platforms, you know, open platforms where people can contribute, put it up there, use tools which they can do on their own, and, you know, then have those, the creations be accessible to a wider marketplace, you know, instead of having to go through gatekeepers like galleries or publishing houses and so on and so forth. Let those exist as well, but they should not be the only means through which your work will see the light of day.
So that's fascinating, really. And maybe I can zoom out and link this now back to the idea of freedom in the book itself. Because then you're really saying is that, what you're saying is that democracy is an open platform.
Actually, I think the space really that you're looking at is opportunity. When opportunities become unlimited, then only can freedom be ubiquitous, you know. Without opportunities flowing, if you restrict it in some way, freedom cannot be... freedom cannot seep through the system, and you know, the democracy in which we live in will only be a democracy in name, but not one in actual action.
Well, of course, when you talk about opportunity, you also have to back that up with equality of access.
Absolutely, absolutely. So equality of opportunity is I think what I'm really
right, which is a whole
about.
Holistic process.
Yes, absolutely.
I mean, it's not just at the top, and it's also about the education you have and the health you have and so on.
So everything put together, absolutely.
Right,
everything.
Yes. And finally, let me ask you how you think this will change the publishing business.
Well, I mean, I don't know how it will actually change.
Which is something
change,
you're familiar with in more
yes,
than one
yes.
way.
I mean, the publishing business is something really I've been in my whole life, you know, and in some way it is, I would say, in my DNA in a lot of ways. You know, I don't think I can ever move out of it. But what actually really pains me or troubles me about the publishing industry is is the attitude that everything is okay, you know, that literally right now the house is burning, you know, it's on fire, and people are not recognizing it. You know, it's just like, for example, when the media was acknowledging or media was saying that Hillary Clinton would win, they were actually not acknowledging the ground reality, which is that, people were saying America was broken fundamentally, you know, that's what led to the election of Donald Trump. In the same way, I think, In the publishing industry as well, people are not acknowledging the fact that their basic model is broken. And the basic model is broken is because it's closed. I think people need and want an open model today, you know. And somehow that open model is refusing to emerge from within the existing establishment, you know. That's why I think the disruption is happening from the digital side. Because, you know, they are giving newer people access to creating, to resources, to opportunities, which the publishing industry simply refuses to give, you know?
Yeah. So, you know, something like this would very naturally lend itself to the digital medium.
Absolutely.
But you've chosen to go into print.
Absolutely. I think, the printed word for me is a beautiful medium. There's nothing wrong, mind you, keep in mind. I believe the printed medium will continue to prosper long into the future, you know. There is something very, very beautiful about, words printed on a page. And especially if you look at these illustrations, they lend, on that paper, there's a beauty to it, you know. I could, for example, never imagine Da Vinci's paintings on, just watching it digitally. It wouldn't satisfy me. I would want to see the real thing, you know. So in the same way, I think the problem is not the medium, but the problem is the process that goes into the medium. You know, I think the process needs to get revolutionized, and thereby the medium will get enriched automatically.
But if I can play devil's advocate, I mean, again, to take the example of Da Vinci, most people cannot see a Da Vinci painting with their own eyes, or a large number of people cannot. And the internet has actually made it possible to at least get an idea of what it's like. Earlier, you only had those books with reproductions. And a lot more people can now access high art, for example. So don't you think that print is essentially restrictive and actually goes against the very ethos of what you're talking about?
I would actually disagree with you on that. You know, you're right on the surface. Like if I look at, for example, the example that you just mentioned, Da Vinci's, let's call it this, let's say the, my favorite one is the Sistine Chapel, for example, you know. Now, very few people can afford to actually see the Sistine Chapel. And one of the reasons is that, visas are required for Europe. And then also there are bilateral treaties between India and Italy that govern the number of flights that can operate. Now, those are existing barriers today from the real world that make the cost of traveling to Italy to see the Sistine Chapel exorbitant. But what if, let's say, you had a world where those barriers were demolished and you could travel to Italy the way you travel to Bombay? You had millions of flights, which transportation methods, which were high speed, which could get you there, at low cost. Then, so technology can change the game. That's a question, you know.
Sure.
So I think when you say what you're saying, you're assuming there's a status quo in technology, and that's a mistake which economists have made as well historically, where they have predicted the demise of society on the basis of population growth, but not factoring into account the technological growth which happens. You know.
But technology can't change the experience as well.
Well, the thing is that the physical experience of watching it is unique. For sure. But my point is that why should we actually simply settle for giving the average person a second best option of just a digital? Instead, why not make the average person, why not give him access to the real thing?
Sure. While it's not an either or.
Not an either or.
But the opportunity for the primary experience can sufficiently
yes.
and be
enlarged.
And
needs,
yeah.
to, needs to come down
needs
in cost
to come down, yeah.
because technology.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what we're trying to
yeah,
do.
Yeah, yeah, sure. No, I get well. That, yeah. That's great. Okay, this is a good time to open this to the audience. Questions? Yes, the gentleman in the yellow T-shirt, have I got the color right? Is there a mic there? Can someone take a mic across, please?
Thank you very much. I do agree with you from all the angles, you know. But I have a question, and it is regarding that the way you have described the whole thing, it is something like open source technology, you know. So contributors are coming from different corner, and they're contributing for the great work. and end of the day, this is getting prepared, okay. But my question is this, for the creative work, if I'm a creative artist, from my angle, my level of consciousness is different. The way I am trying to design my stuff, okay? When I'm calling another person to get involved in my work and interpret it according to his way, my work is getting distorted. So how to address this kind of situation? Thank you.
See, it's basically how you see your work, you know? It ultimately ends up with what you want. I'm not saying for that matter that you need to invite someone to necessarily come and collaborate with you. That's ultimately a choice. But I think the point that I'm trying to make is that the option should be available to you, you know, to be able to discover potential contributors, you know, should you require it. And the other thing is that, I mean, it's for you to actually be open to it rather than necessarily forcing it upon yourself. There's a difference in the two, you know, is to have lots of options at disposal is what I'm actually talking about.
Ritwick, do you feel that anxiety that you might be destroying somebody's work by collaborating or adding to it?
I don't think so. It's you could get a space as well, not destroying something. Sometimes, like, there are a couple of...
Sorry? Right, sure. Got it. Yes. Yeah, please do.
So, I mean, when I conceived of the story for the first time, you know, I mean, if you read the prose, it's fairly dark and dystopian, you know, in the vision that I was portraying. It was more like, I would say, a classic kind of graphic novel kind of a world. But when Ritwick came in and he interpreted the same work, I was also a bit apprehensive initially that, you know, would he depart from it? But then he added a spunk and a vibrancy to it. The use of colors and overall with the characterization, which I hadn't conceived of before, and which actually works very well in the final output. So his interpretation actually enriched it. But that is not to say that any interpretation will enrich it. It's always a matter of risk. I'm pretty sure there'll always be someone you can find who can enrich it further. You know, I think that's the point. And the important thing is for you to be open to it rather than to foreclose the option.
Sure, yes. Thank you. Any other questions? Yes. Okay, in the second row here and then at the back. I'll come to you. Yes, the lady here in the second row. Oh, you've got a mic? All right, go ahead. Go ahead, yeah.
I'd like to talk about the freedom that you're talking about. You said that right now we have a different kind of freedom. And now we need religious freedom. I mean, people collaborating with each other on the topics. But... I mean, different people have different ideologies, and it is not necessary that one person's ideology will another person is...
Okay, they won't match. Yeah. So what's your question?
A world where people collaborate in harmony is not going to occur in...
You're saying it's impossible.
Yeah, it's impossible.
I definitely understand where you're going, because that's what we see, you know, in the media today. But, you know, we can't be limited by what we see, you know, right now. You know, we have to see, we have to imagine what can be rather than what is, you know. And therein what I feel that, you know, historically, it's always been an us versus them kind of a situation where, you know, if my ideology matches yours, then I will have a conversation with you. Otherwise, you can, you know, get lost. And to be honest with you, has that taken humanity far? In its, you know, in its quest for happiness, I don't think so. You know, we also, I think, as individuals, all of us, you know, we need to mature, and we need to recognize that there are different points of view that exist, and you know, we need to have conversations with people with all different points of view. And while this is also something which will take time, it requires a certain degree of consciousness and evolution, but. Surprisingly, you know, I do feel that technology can help in that process as well, you know, by bringing people closer together and in a more meaningful way rather than in the way that exists right now. You know? But this problem which he was pointing out, I mean, it is there very much today.
It is very much a real problem.
Especially in our country.
Right, yes. Okay, yes, the lady here.
Yeah, thank you very much. First of all, I must congratulate you. It sounds very exciting when I'm listening to the entire thing, and... dealing with such a sensitive topic, and it's not only about China or India, it's global. So, and putting it in a new format, it's very, very interesting and exciting. My question specifically is, you were talking about paradigm shift, and you were also talking about technology playing a role in that paradigm shift. But we have often seen technology playing a complete different role. So how do you ensure that technology will actually lead to a positive paradigm shift, or the paradigm shift majority of the people would like to see, or beneficial for the people?
Well, the thing is that, you know, you need champions, essentially. You know, that the technology, though, by and large, has been really like, you know, the through the efforts of innovators, you know, great men, largely men also, I can tell you, which is a bad thing. The female point of view has rarely come into technology, which is one of the reasons I have a very strong female character. So what is there in technology, if you really see, is currently, I mean, and most of the companies, and I know most of them, you know, being the approach is really to, support the system which exists already, largely because the business model is dependent on the system that exists. If you understand what I mean by the system that exists, you know. But you need companies which actually take on a more transformative role, in a sense, technology companies, which don't really accept the way things are. You see, disruption can happen from anywhere. You cannot predict it. You know, it's it can, and the beauty with technology is that it is accessible everywhere in the world. You know, but I would say that you need people with that kind of consciousness that starts coming up with bigger ideas, and you need also, to some extent, an investment environment in technology, which is missing right now, which supports big ideas such as this. So most of the technology companies that are coming out now are very, you know, a sort of more tactical in nature, rather than, these kinds of big ideas that I'm talking about. But I do believe it's possible. You know, you wait and watch. I think there's a shift in the political environment right now as well. And I do feel that things will change.
Right, thank you. Yes, the gentleman at the back.
Good evening, sir. I want to congratulate on your book. Since you touched on the topic of freedom, I wanted to ask, should freedom be absolute and unrestrained in a democratic society, as we have seen many a times that especially freedom of speech and expression have repeatedly been attacked by the rulers of a democratic society? So according to you, should it be absolute and unrestrained?
I mean, that is a big question, isn't it? I mean, my whole idea was to raise that question, not to answer it at this point. But I have tried to answer it in a subsequent book, you know. But at this point, I don't think it would be proper for me to really get into that, because it's a very, very deep question that you're asking, and one that requires a lot of work, a lot of conversations also, before one can really grapple upon it, you know. So, if I have raised that question, I think I feel really happy about that. But unfortunately, I don't think I can give an answer to that at that point. You know, it's what you feel inside at the end of the day. You know?
So, commercial announcement, you might get some answers to that from the next panel. Yes, any other questions? Anybody? So what are your next plans now? How soon are the next books coming?
We are going to come out with another book next year, and this will be a more mainstream book, in a sense that this will not be a graphic novel, but it'll be a work of philosophy. But there will be an innovation in it, which is probably maybe even of a higher level than what you're seeing here in the book itself. But it's a mainstream book, and thereafter I have more dual-facing novels planned, including one which I'm actually really trying to attack this whole model of religion. Essentially, you know, that book I hope to complete within the next, let's say, by another 2 years. And that's a fairly bigger, much larger work than this one in terms of the scale. And in the meantime as well, we're continuously discovering new authors, you know. So if anyone wants to write, submit the scripts, you know, we'd be very open to that. And keep on nurturing, the ecosystem. I think that's basically the mission. Right. I'm just a messenger, in a sense. You know, I'm not really I don't see myself as a writer per se. I see myself more as a thought starter in that sense, you know. But I mean, through this effort, if I can inspire others to follow suit, I'd be, you know, that my work would be done.
Well, that's very interesting. I mean, you're also putting forth a new model of the writer.
Yes, exactly.
Not just of books and publishing. Right, thank you very much. On that note, we are going to close this session. Thank you, both of you, Ritwick and Aritra, and thank you for being here this afternoon. Thanks very much.